there's actually several myths that come into retirement planning, and you know, people say, well, follow the 4% rule. Please, yeah. Right? Yeah. Yeah. Just take 4% and have a 60-40 portfolio. That's no, yeah. That's not a plan.
Okay? By the way, when they say 4%, they're thinking net 4%.
Yeah, that's what they're thinking. That's yeah. But Uncle Sam's there waiting yeah, with right. his hand out, right? Yeah. All right, Bud Kasper, welcome.
We ought to have the total number of shows we've done. This is show number 1,332.
It's a lot. It's a lot, dating back into the mid-2000s. Yeah. So, yeah, a lot. Hey, so today, obviously, want to welcome all of our listeners, also all of our viewers. If you didn't know, we are on YouTube and also on your favorite podcast app with a new show released every Monday and Thursday. So if you haven't subscribed to either YouTube or the podcast channel, get out there and make sure to subscribe. And if you enjoy the program, share it with your friends. So we're going to be diving into an issue as a survey that's been done by the Employee Benefit Research Institute, and it is 2022 Spending in Retirement Survey. And they go into understanding the pandemic's impact, but I think there's more here than just the pandemic itself. So as we dive into this Employee Benefit Research Institute topic here of 2022 spending in retirement, there were some things in here that really surprised me, Bud. I'm not sure about you.
You know, I found this a fascinating read, and now that I've had this exposure to it, it's something I'm going to go back and frequent from time to time just to get a better understanding on the data. And I'm not sure in reading this that it applies to all of our listeners, our viewers, if you will, but we'll give you the parameters that was set up by this organization, independent, I might add, so that we're really looking at, are people ready to retire? Have they prepared enough? Do they truly understand what success they might have or failing that they might have?
And of course, you know, one of the things that happens when you head into retirement, you lose the confidence that you had while you were working, because it was things were crystal clear in retirement or in your working years, because you knew how much was coming in. You knew that your health insurance had already come out of your paycheck, your 401k deposit had already come out of your paycheck, your taxes had already come out of your paycheck, and you knew how much was being deposited in your checking account. And so you knew what you could actually spend. And so it's not a simple math problem to be able to figure out how much can you safely spend. And I think that's where a lot of people fall short, Bud, is it's not a simple math problem, and people think it's a simple math problem. And, you know, we kind of dive into some of this here, but here's something that caught me right up front is more than half of the people surveyed here retired earlier than they expected, right? We've done a show before on will you really get to retire on your own terms? And we know that a lot of people don't retire on their own terms. And in this survey, it found that more than half retired earlier than expected. And there was some of those, 29%, said they could retire earlier from an affordability standpoint, but a big percentage were retiring because of a health-related problem or a disability not related to COVID-19. And so we've seen that on really both sides where, you know, somebody retires and maybe it's not their health, maybe it's the health of their spouse or the health of a parent or something like that, where they have to leave the workforce in order to care for somebody, or they just can't work any longer.
Yeah. And this is going to sound self-serving, but what I want people to understand is there's a lot of people in this survey. I think it was 1,999 people in the survey, something close to that. But do they really understand how to assess what they have and what their spending patterns will be in order to have success, but not success for the next year or 5 years, for their lifetime? And I don't believe that any of these people in this survey, and this could be a mistake on my part, truly understand what goes into retirement planning and how you have to understand the definitions associated with retirement planning in terms of sources of income, taxes, et cetera, to know whether or not your probability of success, Dean, is good, fair or bad?
Right. Well, I could tell you that this is my 36th year as a financial advisor, and I think you're 40 years. Mm-hmm. And when we think about the number of people that we have met over the years that have sat down with us for the first time and they said, here's my detailed retirement plan. I can count on one hand the number of people that I've met that actually had a real financial plan before we met them.
No.
And we're talking about people mostly in their mid to late 50s or early 60s that are saying, okay, now it's time. I need to talk to somebody. And or it's people that are already in retirement and they still don't have a plan. And so they're flying by the seat of their pants. So I think you're right, bud. There are the vast majority of people do not have a financial plan or detailed plan of how they're going to get their income in retirement and how much is safe to spend.
You know, I would encourage people to go onto YouTube and watch last week's show. Because if you remember, we were supposed to list the five most important things that I put it, and then you did the same thing with that.
Absolutely.
And I thought that was a great show for the single purpose that people can understand where our minds are as professional advisors, you know, is in terms of what people need to recognize before they ever enter into retirement. If you look at this report, the ages for this survey was 62 to 75. Well, that's pretty fair. I think that's the target, you know, that we generally are speaking about with all this. And in the first statement, it says it here is that 7 in 10 said Social Security was a major source of their income. Now, when you think about that and you extrapolate what that number would be for a couple, for a person, are you both filing at the same time? Is it wise for you to file for your Social Security benefits? Should it be postponed? Why would you postpone money that you could be yours? Answer is because it has the ability to grow, you know, when you're not utilizing it. There's so many variables associated with this. And what this survey is doing is really taking the attitude of people who are in retirement with what they understood they owned at the time and sources of income and asking the question, can I make it happen?
Well, I think when it's not surprising that 7 in 10 said Social Security was a major source of income, and here's why. Approximately half of the nearly 2,000 people that were surveyed said they spend less than $2,000 each month, while 1 in 3 spend somewhere between $2,000 and $4,000 per month. Only 16% spend between $4,000 and $7,000 a month, and only 3% report spending more than $7,000 each month. And so, but if you had an individual who had maxed out their Social Security and they were going to get the highest possible amount and they're of full retirement age, their Social Security alone is going to be over $40,000, roughly $40,000 a year. Mm-hmm. And then even if their spouse didn't work, their spouse is going to get half of what their full retirement benefit is. So you're talking about $60,000 a year or $5,000 a month for somebody who maxed out. So if only 3% are spending $7,000 or more per month, I can see why 7 in 10 said that Social Security is a major source of income. And I think people really need to understand how Social Security works way before they go to claim. And there's one of these myths out there. There's actually several myths that come into retirement planning. And you know, people say, well, follow the 4% rule, please,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Just take 4% and have a 60-40 portfolio. That's not a plan.
Okay? By the way, when they say 4%, they're thinking net 4%.
That's what they're thinking. But Uncle Sam's there waiting with his hand out, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
And then another, I think, myth out there that needs to be debunked is that the date that you claim Social Security is synonymous with the date that you retire. Mm-hmm. Now, that may be true, and it may be a good idea for some people, but for a couple age 62, most will have over 600 different iterations of how they can claim their Social Security, and the difference between the best and worst claiming strategy based on the same earnings history and the same life expectancy could be $100,000 or more of additional lifetime income from Social Security. So you got to get that right. So don't just, you know, don't fall into the myth of the 4% rule or that you claim Social Security right when you retire. That's just simply not true. Let's go to this other one here. It says that retirees reported that nearly a third of their monthly income goes toward housing expenses.
Yeah. You know, and of course, the issue would be is you should be endeavoring, if at all possible, you know, to eliminate your mortgage payment, if you will, by the time you're ready to retire. These are preparation steps, I'll call it, of ways of eliminating those expenses that could be eliminated if you had a program, a plan, if you will, to do so by the by your retirement date, which isn't necessarily 62, okay? In fact, I would say, and I'm making this up, I would say at least 80, 85% of my clients are retiring after the age of 62. Why? Because they're serious people. They understand that they need to evaluate all income sources and try to maximize the result to what their income goals are going to be, not just in a single year, but into the future as well, with an inflation factor popped in there as well.
Yeah, and you know, sometimes the whole healthcare issue is a big issue of why people won't retire prior to 65 before they're eligible for Medicare. But there are people that they don't know that they can afford to pay for health insurance prior to being eligible for Medicare, so they just put it off, or they don't even talk to somebody like you or I or any of the other CFPs that are part of our Modern Wealth Management team, and so. I think that, you know, the retirement date is something that you need to really be talking about with your significant other, with your financial planner. And by the way, we do have something that I think can help everybody, and that is our retirement plan checklist.
That's a wonderful booklet.
So we put this together several years ago. We've updated it, and it goes through not just getting you to retirement, but also things after retirement. And there's an age-based timeline. There is also a timeline 5 years out, 1 year out, 6 months out, etc. What are the things that you need to be doing? And then there's actually a 30-question checklist that you can go through. And these are simple yes or no questions. Have you thought of these things? And so I believe, Bud, that the people that have taken advantage of getting this checklist, the people that have taken the time to go through this and answer these questions and have meaningful conversations with certified financial planners, and really this touches all the bases that people need to be thinking about as they lead into retirement, and even as they get, you know, that first 5 and even 10 years into retirement, this checklist is pertinent throughout your lifetime.
I can't tell you the number of those that I've given out to people who just called because they wanted to learn more about retirement, you know, and it's a proprietary document that is created by our firm, Modern Wealth Management, and it will give you insight. I guarantee you, you will not waste a second of your time in going through this booklet, if you will, and addressing the questions to yourself, as we've addressed it in the book, to challenge people to think about things that are necessary for them to have retirement success.
All right, so let's continue on here with some of the other things in this survey that were interesting. Okay. So the retirees were more likely to report that their spending is much higher or a little higher than they can afford in 2022. It was only 17% of retirees reported that their expenses were higher or a little higher than they could afford in 2020. But by 2022, 27% of retirees reported that their spending is much higher or a little higher than they can afford. And they indicated that their spending is higher than they can afford. Number one reason, inflation.
Sure. Yeah, the nemesis that actually takes money out of your pocket as you continue to live your life.
We call it the silent killer.
Oh, that's an appropriate word to use with that, or phrase to say.
And typically inflation doesn't cause you to go broke, but it'll cause you to live like you're broke.
Yes. Dean has all these little sayings that are absolutely pearls. Pearls, folks.
But I was surprised by this 27% that are actually spending more than they can afford. Well, what does that tell me? That tells me that at some point they're likely to run out of money and will then be a burden on their children. And typically when they're going to be a burden on their children is just when their children are getting to retirement age.
So if you were to take in and prioritize the things that you should be thinking about in your preparation for retirement, the first thing that I would look at is my debt. You know, how much debt do I have? Am I going to retire and still have to service debt that I still have out there? So if you could eliminate or reduce that substantially so it's not taking away that income that you could be utilizing for your lifestyle, that would be a great benefit to you to start with.
Right. I believe we did a program on good debt versus bad debt.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you're on YouTube or your favorite podcast app, you'll find that episode as well. And there's a lot to talk about in the realm of debt. And each individual situation is going to be different, but there is some good debt. But by and large, I don't like it.
Yeah. But let's look at the other part of this. You know, what do you know you're going to get? And if you've had a job at all and you've paid into Social Security is going to be a sound source of income. Now, when you claim that Social Security, though, is somewhat of a challenge because you have to take into impact what your benefit would be, let's say at 62, 64, 66, you know, so on and so forth, because obviously it's growing exponentially if you're not taking it out. So if you say, well, I'm gonna retire at 62, understand what that benefit would be, understand whether your spouse is old enough to claim the benefit along with you, and then challenge yourself to say, what if I were to postpone this for another year, 2 years? Well, you might say, ladies and gentlemen, that, you know, I don't know how to do that. Well, of course you don't. No, very few people would. That's why we are here, to be able to help people understand the ability to be able to manage various sources of asset to maximize the result in terms of annual income.
Well, I've got a story on that, Bud.
Okay.
And this just happened within the last couple of weeks. So a client of mine that has been a client for a long period of time, we intentionally chose for him to do a spousal application for Social Security. So his wife worked as well as him. She claimed, and then he claimed a spousal benefit instead of claiming his own benefit. And in claiming his spousal benefit, what that allowed him to do was collect half of his wife's Social Security, and he turned 70 this year, and now he gets his own benefit. And his own benefit is now up to $4,000 per month.
Maxed it out.
He maxed it out. At the same time, he was diagnosed about a year and a half ago with a disease that has been tied to Agent Orange in Vietnam. And so he is also now eligible for full disability from the VA. And so he's not only going to get his $4,000 a month in Social Security up from about $1,200, mm-hmm. so a nice raise there. Mm-hmm. Now he's also going to get this disability benefit, which is going to be almost another $4,000 a month. And so we had a long conversation with the CPA about, okay, let's do this wisely. He has a lot of money still in IRAs. We've converted a pretty substantial portion, but he's still got about $400,000 in traditional IRAs.
For our audience, converting means moving from a taxable to a
tax-free to the Roth IRA. Mm-hmm. And so now what we're doing is we're putting together a side-by-side comparison because we know that it's highly unlikely that he and his wife are going to need to spend the vast majority of the assets they're accumulating, mm-hmm. or they have accumulated. Mm-hmm. So it's going to do two things. Number one, it's going to change the mindset of our timeline for investing that money, knowing that that money is likely now going to be for children and grandchildren. And we're thinking about using the VA disability benefit to pay for Roth conversions over the next couple of years to get all of his money moved into Roth IRA.
Yeah,
with the exception, we'll leave a little bit in the traditional IRA because he is charitably inclined. And so we can get some of the money out of the traditional IRA by doing qualified charitable distributions or QCDs. That gets the money out of the IRA tax-free to get to charities. Bottom line is that all came about not just because of the VA disability, but because of the way that we claim Social Security. We had that plan. Now that we're just going to be able to accelerate getting the rest of that money moved over to a Roth IRA. Right.
And let me add an additional planning point that you brought up, Dean, and that is the fact that if he were to pass, because he postponed taking his Social Security when he could, he got the maximum benefit and the spouse gets the higher of the two, hers or his, in this case his. So it benefited the longevity of the plan for his wife.
Absolutely. And if we can get everything into a tax-free environment now here over the next couple of years, if he happens to predecease her, not only is she going to get that larger disability benefit, but the vast majority of their assets will then be in Roth IRAs, which means that the income coming off the Roth IRAs is tax-free and Social Security is tax-free because you stay below the provisional income limits.
That's right. There are limits that would make it taxable, but if you don't have any taxable income to report, it's tax-free.
That's right.
Hey, folks, this is planning.
This is all about planning.
This is actually the essence of why we do this program.
Well, so here's a couple other items that I want to mention here, Bud. One is that on average, retirees reported a satisfaction retirement of just 7 out of 10. That was in 2022. That was compared to 7.4 in 2020. And they also, when they related their alignment of life in retirement to what the expectations were, it's only at 6.4,
mm-hmm.
right? So, you know, that's kind of like saying, yeah, it's about what I expected, or no, it's not quite as good as what I expected. And the people that reported, Bud, that they had a lower sense of well-being in retirement, one of the main factors was they didn't have a financial plan.
Right?
Yeah. We harp on that so much.
Yeah, and I know it sounds somewhat self-serving, but ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you that this is the missing part. This is the part of the unknown. Whether Uncle Sam's reaching in your pocket for more tax or whatever the case may be, we need to help you understand what your options are.
All right, what have we learned? We've learned that if you have a plan, if you go in with your eyes wide open, you've used our retirement plan checklist, you've gone through, you've answered all these questions, there won't be any surprises in retirement. This is a different phase of life. Rules change on investing, taxes, Social Security, etc. And without a plan, you're going to be lost. Get the retirement plan checklist and then click the button that says schedule a meeting and get a conversation started with one of our certified financial planner professionals. We appreciate you joining us here on America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barber along with Bud Kasper. Till next time, be healthy and be safe.
Expressed represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.